because they have such joy on their faces and they always look so nice, but they sing from the heart. That's the most important thing. They sing from the heart. And that's what happens when you know that you sing not only for yourself, but for others, but that you sing of the greatness of God, right?
Yeah.
You sing for the greatness of God. And what about those dancers? Holy smoke! I love that. Rise again. And they put motion to the text, to the words. That we rise again, not because of who we are, but because of who God is. And they reminded us in that song, go ahead, mop my neck. Go ahead, put those nails in my hand. Go ahead, make fun of me. But guess what? I'm going to rise again. Right? Not because of who we are, but because of who God has made us to be. And that is something to celebrate. Right? This week when I was considering this text from Matthew, I was like, Matthew, what are you talking about? Do not be afraid. So let's give some context to the Bible passage, right? So the people, the Marys experienced this earthquake. And yet they're told, don't be afraid. Now, I've lived in California for 54 years of my life, right? And I can tell you, we have earthquakes in California. And there are days that I wake up rocking and rolling while I was sleeping in my bed, right? And not once did I say, oh, it's going to be okay. Oh, it's going to be okay. So here's this earthquake, and then these messengers appear. Right now, I don't know about you, but the only messenger I look forward to seeing every single day on my way to church is the barista at Starbucks. Because I know they're going to have some fuel for me, right? And I like going in there and teasing those guys and those girls. Kirk, did you hear me? Those girls. Kirk has to go in there and make sure I'm behaving myself. Right? But let me tell you something. If I was walking down the street going to check something out and something appeared in front of me, I wouldn't want to be not afraid because I think I was losing my mind. And then they are told, don't be afraid, but go and do something. Go and tell people what you're seeing. Go and tell people what you're experiencing. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
After seeing the person that they love the most crucified, and dying the horrible, violent, barbaric death, a death that God did not script. God did not choose for Jesus to come to earth to teach about love and healing and then to die a barbaric death. And God doesn't choose that for any of us either, by the way. Jesus died that death at the power-hungry hands of human beings. That's why Jesus died. And then what happened? As the Marys were going to check out, Jesus just prepared the body, the earth quakes, the messengers come, the stone is not yet rolled away, but they sit on the stone. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? When you go visit somebody who means something to you and you see somebody who might be disrespecting their place, imagine what those women might have felt. Yet they are told, do not be afraid. The Jesus that you are looking for is not here. He has raised from the dead. And just go a step further. Come and see for yourself. That's what made the difference for me in this text. Come and see the place. Come and see the place where you know they put the body. Because guess what? The body is not there. I've thought about that a lot this week. Because the Marys respond with a lot of joy at that point, right? And then they get busy. They go and they tell what they had seen and what they heard. What they heard from the angels, from the messengers. So they're living simultaneously in this reality of fear and joy. Fear and joy. And how many of us live in that same reality of fear and joy? If you get honest with yourself, you realize that we probably go through a lot of those similar experiences every single day of our lives. Fear at the bad news that a coworker shares with you. What about the fear that somebody you care about has been given a horrendous diagnosis and they do not know what's going to happen? What about the fear when you hear again about another executive order that's been signed in our government, right? What about the fear that comes when you hear about another attempt to hurt somebody from the violence of racism or sexism or classism or ableism? We have fear, church, don't you think? And it's right to have fear. And simultaneously, we have to say, we hear bad news sometimes at our jobs, but then we live in joy at the relationships that we might have with some of our coworkers. We live in joy when we get that paycheck. I don't know about you, but I checked 2 days before the date. It's in my bank account. I'm so grateful. We do the same thing, right? What about the joy that comes when you hear that a loved one's treatment is working and new life has been given? We experience joy in that. Or what about the joy that we experience when we dare show up and protest against some of those executive orders in a non-violent way, where we go and say, wait a minute, this is not right, and you're going to have to be confronted that we will stand for justice, not injustice. That we will stand against marginalization and violence. Right? Because that's the reality of living a life of redemption, of resurrection. That's what's so wonderful about the tomb being empty. It's not about the death. It's about the reality that when we ask God to change things, guess what, church? Things are going to happen. Things are going to change. Things are going to change. Right? Some of you live in fear that I'm going to continue to spread glitter around this church. Guess what? It's going to happen. Right? It's going to happen. Some of you get nervous when I say we're going to take our rainbow flags and go out there and confront those people that wave Confederate flags. We're going to do that. Why are we going to do that? Because the tomb is empty. Because the tomb is empty. And God says, I reign over death. You see, fear does not ever have the last word. Joy gets the last word. And I'm not talking about our beloved Dr. Joy here. I'm talking about joy. The joy that wells up within us that we cannot contain. Because that doesn't come from us. That comes from God. And yet we have to be able to look at ourselves, I think, like the Marys. And ask ourselves, what does it matter to us that the tomb is empty, that Jesus is risen, that life is changed? You know, scholars debate, and I love it. This is the seventh congregation I've served, 32 years of ministry. I know some of you go, woo, he's more than 32. Looking good. I can tell you there have been times that I read the Bible and say, resurrection? Oh, come on, give me a break. Virgin birth? Really? How can that happen in the reality of humanness? And that's the question. It's the reality of humanness. How can any of it happen? How can we explain that we wake up every day to a new day? That we are given another opportunity to live in freedom, to live as people who have been redeemed, to live as people who can stand up and make a difference in this world. And often that happens when we will not allow our pain and brokenness to rule who we are. Amen, church? That's right. You see, Just because of the resurrection, we are not guaranteed that we are not going to go through difficult days. We are not guaranteed that we're not going to have pain. We are not guaranteed that we're going to have questions. But what we are guaranteed is we never have to face anything in life alone, because those negative things do not have the last word for people who invite God into the midst of that. And I mean God as you understand God, not as I understand God. Right? How do you understand God? That's the question. And can you dare invite God into those two experiences of your world? Can you dare believe that your life can be different because of God's love and because of God's grace? Gifts that we are given freely by a God who always meets us, and has good things for us, even when we don't think so. And why is that possible? Because of the empty tomb. Because God has the last word. Always. Always. And when we think it is not so, watch out, because the glitter is going to come. Your world is going to be rocked. Your world is going to be jarred. That's what the earthquake is about. And as you experience the earthquake, you will receive messages from God. Sometimes that's in the face of people that you interact with at your job, or in your home, or at your church. Sometimes it's in the kindness of a barista. Sometimes it's just in the smile as you pass somebody by walking their dog. But it's always there, church. Because God has good gifts for us. Always. Always. So what does it mean to you, the resurrection? What does it mean to you that you are loved by God no matter what? What does it mean to you that because of Jesus' life and ministry, God's heart was broken at Jesus' death? And God said, oh no, this death will not have the last word. Jesus will rise. Jesus will rise. And that's how we know we are loved. On Friday night, we nailed our concerns and our prayers, our sin and brokenness, whatever that might mean to you, to the cross that was here at the altar. Today, on this piece of paper, write on this paper, where do you experience God? What have you experienced from God? What joy do you have that has come from somewhere that you cannot explain? Write it on this paper. And as you come to celebrate Holy Communion this morning, I would ask you to take your paper and on these nails that were put in this cross on Good Friday, put your paper. And let this cross be a visual representation to you of transformation. Transformation given to us because of God's love and God's grace. Gifts that we are given. It is also fitting that we would put these concerns on the cross after we have feasted from the table of liberation, the table of freedom, the table that stands against injustice and violence because of God. So church, it's a good thing to know that Jesus is risen. Can we say it together? Jesus is risen. Is that how excited you are?
Jesus is risen.
Jesus is what?
Risen.
Jesus is risen. And all of us say together, Amen.